after the military coup of 2009 that ousted President Manuel Zelaya, forcing him out of the country, the power of armed forces has increased in all spheres of government. Their power continues to grow with President Juan Hernández.
The coup is an event that has taken us back to the circumstances the country was living in the 1960s, 70s, and 80s, when the military intervened in politics and democracy, and when their role began to become increasingly important. We have been observing that since the coup, the army is no longer limited to their barracks. They now have other functions. They have launched a program called Guardians of the Nation, aimed at teaching children military ideology.
We shouldn't be fooled by the idea that the armed forces are imposing themselves on the government. It is completely the other way around. The president came out very weak from last year's general elections and has decided to militarize security and society to strengthen himself because he lacks popular support.
Initially, militarization was implemented as a measure to face the ongoing protests against the coup, and it was used to attack the popular resistance movement. The argument now is that militarization is required to substitute corrupt police units, and it is highly funded through taxes and U.S. funds supposedly destined to aid the country's drug war.
There is a militarization of security forces, which began in the prior government, which is also from the Nationalist Party of Hernández. His government has given increased powers to the armed forces under the pretext of cleaning up the police force.
Human rights organizations have expressed concern that attacks against the resistance movement and opposition continue to occur as they did back in the 80s, when hundreds of Hondurans were killed because the government tagged them as enemies of the state.
Vimos cómo ellos tenían unidades.
They have units and structures that operate to eliminate and disappear members of the opposition. The military created death squads that today are simply hitmen. It is the government's aim to make the people believe we live in an insecure and violent country. What they don't want us to know is that we are faced with a criminal state and criminal policies against political opposition. We are living today under the same circumstances as in the 80s.
Today we see military police and soldiers all around the city, stopping cars, stopping people, detaining youth, and we believe that by no means will this improve security. Instead, they are creating and spreading further fear among the population.
Honduras is presently the most violent country in the world, with a rate of 90 murders per 100,000 inhabitants. An average of 20 persons are killed in the country, mainly in Tegucigalpa and San Pedro Sula. The nation's government spends more on security than in health and education combined.
We expect more repression and more control over society in general. In the last 2 weeks, we have witnessed two very important cases that prove that people should be very careful. The first one is the one about a small bus with 15 passengers that was shot at by militarized police because it failed to heed orders to stop. Four people were seriously injured. The other case involves El Corpus, which is a mine in the southern area of Choluteca, where approximately 4 or 8 members of the military tortured several workers of the mine.
There is a common denominator, which is impunity. The impunity of the past is the impunity of today. And those who benefit from this impunity are the same economic and political powers. They are the same elements that are responsible for municipal security. They are the same elements from the past that have come to create an atmosphere of insecurity to sell security policies today.